Man, I've been playing a lot of games I really hate lately. Let's play a game that I actually really like. Duh.
Hey everyone, Jarek the Gaming Dragon here. If you're already subscribed and you haven't clicked that bell, be sure to do that, otherwise YouTube won't tell you that I posted anything. If you haven't subscribed, well, watch this video and maybe consider subscribing if you like it. The Darkness 1 is genuinely one of my favorite games of all time. But in 2012, when The Darkness 2 came out, I found myself greatly disappointed compared to the original and never played it again. Well, I decided to play through both The Darkness 1 and 2 on stream over the last week to see if my opinion had changed. So in this video, we're going to be talking about, is The Darkness 1 better than The Darkness 2? When I streamed The Darkness 1 and 2, I streamed them on different platforms. I streamed The Darkness 1 on Xbox 360 and The Darkness 2 on PC. The reason for this is because the original Darkness isn't on PC, which is unfortunately my biggest complaint about it. You see, The Darkness 1 came out early on in the Xbox 360 and PS3 lifetime. The PS3 version is horribly unoptimized, having a lot of framerate issues and stutters quite a bit. The Xbox 360 version is better, but still suffers from the early 360 problems. The framerate, while being better than the PS3 version, still goes all over the place and at best is 30 anyway. The resolution is sub-720p. There's tons of motion blur, and the controls, while not being as bad as people will say they are, I mean seriously, people make it sound like the controls make this game unplayable. They're not that bad, but they're still not that great. The aiming feels like you're moving your cursor through molasses. It's kind of awkward. You will get used to it, and it eventually won't be that much of an issue, but you have to heavily rely on the auto-aim in-game. So unfortunately, it's just sort of a product of people not really knowing what they were doing with that console generation yet. The Darkness 2, on the other hand, came out in 2012, 5 years later, and at that time people had a lot more experience with the Xbox 360 and PS3, but that doesn't mean anything to me because it also came out on PC, whereas the original did not. I can't tell you how much I would love The Darkness 1 to be on PC, just because I'd like to be able to play it in a way that feels natural. I want to be able to play it in a resolution that's native to today's standards, in a way that's smoother and doesn't have motion blur, in a way where the framerate doesn't drop constantly, in a way where I can actually aim with the mouse, which would alleviate all of the weird cursor moving through molasses feeling. It was sort of relieving when I installed The Darkness 2 and then realized, wow, I don't have to do anything. I don't have to do any workarounds, I don't have to change anything, it has an FOV slider, everything I want in a PC game is here. I do have one big complaint about The Darkness 2, however, and that's that the aiming is still really weird. It doesn't feel like there's mouse acceleration or off by any means, but it does something that's incredibly puzzling, and I didn't figure this out until I was streaming it just yesterday. As you are going through the aim down sight animation, your aim will be locked to the center of your screen. You could be moving your mouse at a steady pace to the left, and the moment you start aiming down the sights, your aim stops until the animation is done. You know the whole point of aiming down sights to begin with, to better aim? Who the fuck thought it would be a good idea to make it so that I couldn't aim? I played about halfway through the game, and I was just trying to figure out why things felt so weird until I finally realized this was why. Why would you do this? I just don't get it. To make things worse, the ADS sensitivity feels kind of slow to me, and you can't change it. I realized when playing Battlefield, I prefer it to be around 79% of my hipfire sensitivity, and since I can't change it, it still feels awkward and not natural to me. But an even bigger problem than that I never got adjusted to is when you're dual-wielding. For some odd reason, they made it so that your primary weapon will always be left-click. Obviously, left-clicking is going to shoot the gun you were holding in your right hand. But when you start dual-wielding, you have a gun in your left hand. So naturally your mind thinks, well, if I left click it should shoot the left gun, if I right click it should shoot the right gun, but no, it's inverted. If you left click it will always shoot the right gun, even if you're dual wielding. My mind could not get adjusted to this at any point, and it still confused me to the end of the game. I eventually just settled on always having an automatic in my right hand so that I could at least figure out that left clicking was going to be an automatic. But still, why not just revert this around? That's so confusing. So it's nice that this is a good PC release and it is a step up from The Darkness 1, which wasn't on PC at all, but man, I'm just baffled as to why they did these things. Speaking of baffling, the art style is something that confuses the hell out of me. Graphically, these two games look fine by their times, I guess, but the art style I don't get. The Darkness 1 looks like this. This looks good to me. The Darkness 2, ugh. Why? Why did you do this? This looks butt ugly. Okay, I get it. Art is subjective, but to me, this looks ugly as hell, and I never liked it. Your art style is going to dictate the entire tone of the game, and the tone of The Darkness 2 is so different from the tone of the first game. This just looks like walking around New York City. This looks like I'm walking around in a superhero movie. And the way the world talks and interacts with you totally encourages what I'm thinking. In The Darkness One, you're this quiet, reserved dude in New York City in a terrible situation, taken in as an orphan by someone and turned into a hitman, and now the mafia is against you. You never spoke out too loud, but you did what had to be done for your own life and for everyone around you. In The Darkness 2, you are the Don yourself, and everyone in the world knows who you are and worships you and knows your name. You are the cool kid, and you even speak differently. See how different this is? And I don't know why, but this also applies to everyone in the game.
Grinder's Lane. This is the center of Paulie's operation. The place always makes me want to kick a fucking dog. Or something.
Right around the time he died, my father said to me, he said, Jackie, you can't outrun your fate, but you sure as hell gotta try. I didn't really know what he meant back then. See, there was something inside me. Something terrible. Waiting to get out. And when it did, it made me watch the only thing I ever cared about get her brains blown out right in front of me.
See how different this sounds? One of them sounds like a superhero, the other one sounds like a regular dude. And this sort of applies to everyone in the game. The voice actors were entirely changed, and the ones that weren't still sound really different because the direction that the voice actor was supposed to go is just so different from the first game. I know I'm repeating myself a lot, but the first game feels believable, even with all the random shit happening around you, whereas the second game just kind of feels like an episode of The Sopranos or something. Everyone in The Darkness 2 speaks with this stereotypical accent that doesn't sound genuine.
What did you geniuses find out?
It was Eddie Word. I was otherwise engaged at the time.
He was busy snorting coke off a hooker's ass.
Never could multitask.
Well, these two chuckleheads are getting their dick spit polished. One of the whores starts running their mouth about the new owners.
This is what I really remembered when I first played the game back in the day, and my opinion hasn't changed at all. Characters are difficult to like in The Darkness 2, or difficult to even care about. I won't have those moments like I had at the first Darkness where I actually remember a very specific moment of the story, stuck in my head for the rest of my life. Okay, I'm gonna go more in depth with the story here, and the story is going to be big spoiler and all that stuff, so if you don't want to be spoiled, then I would stop watching the video here. As a warning, again, these two games are very story-driven, so needing to know the story is important, and you really will be missing out on a lot if you want to play these games and you watch this video anyway. I would argue the story is The Darkness One's biggest strength, and it's one of the few games where I do genuinely play a shooter for the story. I know that's crazy, right? I talk very frequently about how having good gameplay and a bad story doesn't mean a whole lot for a shooter if the gameplay is good enough to make it not matter, but in The Darkness One's case, it's the complete opposite. The gameplay is okay, but the story is so good you can't stop playing. For those unaware, The Darkness One was made by Starbreeze Studios, and not the Starbreeze Studios we have today. The people that made The Darkness 1 eventually went on to make the new Wolfenstein games. No matter how you feel about the new Colossus, you know these guys are going to be able to build an immersive, engaging world, and they definitely did that with The Darkness 1. I found myself wanting to just explore the subway stations. This is just a subway in New York City, I have no reason to care about this, but all the random people walking around, the music subtly playing in the background, it is such an engaging experience. The random NPCs still seem like genuine people just walking around New York. You have the crazy dude rambling to himself in the corner, you have the other person having problems paying rent. It just seems like a New York subway. And these are all details that just don't need to be here. They mean nothing to the main story, but the world is so finely crafted, it adds to the experience. It's important too, because this subway serves as a sort of hub world. Do you remember that when games used to have hub worlds instead of being fully open world? Well, The Darkness One was one of those games, with a hub world that's memorable and really not that hard to navigate. It will seem confusing at first until you realize if you press select it'll literally tell you where to go and then you follow the signs to get there, so, you know, not a big deal. Once you understand where you're going, you actually really like it. The Darkness 2, in comparison, is a lot more linear. The levels are straightforward, go shoot the bad guys, and they're simply there just so you can have more things to shoot and level up your abilities. It feels like I'm playing a video game when I play The Darkness 2. It feels like I'm having an experience when I play The Darkness 1. The Darkness 2 does have a hub world in a way, that being your penthouse. You literally live in a mansion, you're the Don. And this is not relatable to 90% of us playing The Darkness. I can relate to walking through the New York subways. I take public transit here in Portland. Even if you don't, you can still relate to it, you've seen it. I can't relate to living in a mansion. It's completely lacking the sort of character that the first game had. That subtle music in the background isn't memorable. The characters don't have amazing voice acting like they did in the first one. Nothing about this just makes me want to keep playing. In fact, it makes me bored in between missions. It makes me want to go shoot more stuff, and that's just the whole point of the game. To put it bluntly, in The Darkness 1, I wanted to shoot more things so that I could talk to more people. In The Darkness 2, I wanted people to stop talking so I could shoot more things. Okay, the story. The thing I warned you about earlier was spoilers. They're both actually not bad when it comes to the whole plot structure, but the execution is way better in the first game. With a far superior direction and voice acting and music and just everything around it, it's so much easier to get invested in The Darkness 1 story than The Darkness 2's. The Darkness 1 is an origin story, but it's one that picks up very quickly. You play as Jackie Estacado, an orphan who was picked up by the Don himself and turned into a hitman. Well, on the 21st birthday, something goes terribly wrong and the Don suddenly doesn't like you anymore. By that I mean you were supposed to pick up money for him, but he puts a hit out on you, so everyone wants you dead. Well, on your 21st birthday, something else horrible also happens. The Darkness makes itself known, coming out on its host's 21st birthday. There's a lot of mystery surrounding the Darkness, and it's difficult to explain. But when you see these giant fanged tentacle things coming out of your back, that is the Darkness. The Darkness has been around for centuries, being passed down from generation to generation, again making itself known on the host's 21st birthday. The Darkness will grant you many powers, only if you were in the dark. If you're in the light, you cannot use the Darkness in any way whatsoever. This sounds great, right? In a video game sense, who doesn't want power? However, you don't have much control over the Darkness, and it has a mind of its own. The Darkness is more of a curse, not a blessing. You aren't a superhero, you're an anti-hero. And none of this alleviates the fact that the mob still wants you dead. Jackie meets up with some of the old members of the crime family that he had been close to his entire life. None of them are happy with how Pauly Franchetti is running the crime family, Pauly Franchetti being the Don that wants you dead. They give you hints throughout the game as to how to hurt his business to make the Chicago families trust him less and hopefully knock him down. Well, as you can predict, every time you hurt him, he comes back to hurt you even worse. This cultivates in some of the most memorable moments in any video game I've ever played. You see, at the beginning of the game, one of the first things you do is meet up with one of the most important characters of the entire franchise, Jenny, Jackie's girlfriend. Well, after you hurt Pauly a few times, it inevitably leads to this cutscene.
Well, just in time. I heard you and your girlfriend grew up here, Estacado. What a shithole.
Broke my nose.
And now the place looks like it was hit by a bomb.
Oh, get up.
What's the matter? Don't know your ass from your elbow with all that demon shit?
You know why we're here? As you heard me, Jackie, I took you in for my own. I trusted you. So now all this blood is on your hands.
Jackie, what's going on? Get me out of here.
Shut the fuck up!
No.
You see a happy ending here, Jackie? You figure you got something to bargain with me so that I don't blow her fucking brains out her fucking nose? Because the way I see it, you got nothing.
It just gets bigger and bigger, don't it, Jackie boy? We hurt you, you hurt us. It's like some fucking game we're playing here. You caused me a lot of trouble, boy.
You were my blood, Jackie. I loved you like a son, and you took from me. You stole my respect, and you stole my trust. And when blood taste from blood, someone always pays. So now, I take from you.
Jackie, this is not your fault.
Clean it, Nessa.
Where are you going? Jackie!
When I think of anything in the Darkness franchise, this is the cutscene that usually comes to mind. Moments like this are what make franchises. It's a small climax within the plot that you were going to remember, and it's not even the big climax of the game. Well, Jackie in the moment ended up killing himself, yet he finds himself in this new, bizarre world. After quite a while of confusion as to why you're wandering around in this hell of a World War I scenario, you eventually meet up with one of your old relatives, your great-great-grandfather, who was the one that brought the darkness into the family. You eventually figure out that this is the darkness's mind, and the darkness is hiding things from you. It becomes a struggle to control the darkness, and this is your time to do so. Before you're able to do that, the darkness fixes you after you shot yourself in the face, and you get shoved back into the New York subway, where everyone is very surprised that you're still alive. The pacing of this game is fantastic, between you being in the subway to a climax against Polly Franchetti to you being shoved into this hell of a World War I scenario. There are numerous conflicts interwoven into a smooth story experience that's easy to understand, intriguing, yet still confusing in all the right ways. There's a lot going on here, but it never feels like there's just too much happening at once. Well, the struggle with Polly Franchetti continues, and you try to take down someone called Eddie Schrott. Eddie Schrott is the corrupt head of the New York Police Department. This cultivates in another incredibly memorable cutscene where you manage to blow up a bomb, killing Eddie Schrott and yourself in the process, sending yourself back to this hell of a World War situation in the darkness's mind. And I just want to take a moment to praise the art direction of this World War I situation. I love things like this. It's unusual, it's bizarre, it's alien, but it works so well with the rest of the game. None of the art here conflicts with any of the other art in the game, but it's obviously very different. Okay, moving on. After a while of trying to figure things out, you eventually find yourself at the core of the darkness's mind. During a brief boss battle, you eventually gain control of the darkness, and once you're fixed up, pushed back into the real world where people are, again, incredibly surprised that you're still alive somehow. But the problem with controlling the darkness is that it can be rather temporary if you continue with chaos. If you continue killing people and doing that general stuff, well, the darkness is eventually going to regain control. This puts you in a bit of a predicament at this moment because you still have to deal with Polly Franchetti, who is still trying to kill you and you need to get rid of him, but if you continue that path, you lose control to the darkness. Jackie's put in a situation where he doesn't have a choice. Things continue to escalate, Polly eventually attacks the entire old family that were originally helping you, and then you find out where Polly is hiding. At this point in the game, the darkness has grown quite strong and you have numerous different powers. This is the real climax of the game. This climax manages to be both a power trip and a struggle at the same time. The enemies have good weapons, there are more enemies than there ever have been, but you do have enough powers to deal with them, and this will make you feel like a total badass just running around murdering everyone, but if you're not careful, you'll die a lot. In fact, that's one of my biggest complaints about The Darkness 2 compared to The Darkness 1. In The Darkness 1, you feel very vulnerable. In fact, you almost feel more powerful in cutscenes than you do in the main game. But the game never conflicts with itself. If you were vulnerable in-game, you were going to be vulnerable in that cutscene. You are not Superman. In The Darkness 1, the transition from gameplay to cutscene makes sense every time. In The Darkness 2, it doesn't. You can go an entire level murdering everyone, and then suddenly in a cutscene get shot once, and that's it. How come I was able to eat all the bullets from all the other enemies trying to kill me? Why does it suddenly matter in a cutscene? In The Darkness 1, if you got shot in the head, whether it was in-game or in cutscene, it didn't matter. The same consequence happened. You ended up dying with the darkness having to fix you. Anyway, back on topic, you go through your murdering spree in Polly Franchetti's safe house, eventually confronting Polly and killing him. This is the last kill you needed to give control back to the darkness. Every action you do comes with a consequence, and this is something Jackie didn't have much choice of. But also at the same time, before you went to go murder Polly Franchetti, the old members of the crime family told you, if you wanted to be the Don, you can be the Don if you can get rid of Polly Franchetti. In The Darkness 1, you successfully managed to take down a corrupt Don, a corrupt police department, fight a battle with a dark mythical curse that has afflicted your family for generations, all while somehow keeping the suspension of disbelief. This does not feel like a superhero movie. This doesn't feel like a comic book. This feels believable, and the characters feel likable. On top of all of this, even though your girlfriend is murdered right in front of you and you know it happened, there's something more going on. You see Jenny's face in this game at numerous odd points, one of which being right in the middle of the darkness's mind. The game never pushed that in your face, but it was there if you looked, and this was something that led to The Darkness 2. At the time of The Darkness 1, I didn't think anything of this, because the darkness lies to Jackie all the time and tries to confuse him, so maybe I thought this is just a trick. Let's compare the story to The Darkness 2. Oh god, sorry, I can't get over this art style. Why did they think this is a good idea? Anyway, the story in The Darkness 2 actually isn't that bad, but it doesn't have the sort of intertwining conflict with, say, Polly Franchetti and The Darkness. Instead, it's almost all about this crazy cult. Yeah, I know, you're likely rolling your eyes. You probably remember the weird cult stuff in the Silent Hill games that just kind of bogged down the story, but it's not too bad in this game, just not as good. It's inherently going to be a little bit more difficult to believe just because it has to do with crazy cult stuff, but, you know, hear me out. At the beginning of The Darkness 2, you are the Dawn yourself. You are this incredibly popular, famous dude that everybody loves, and again, I've said this before, but I hate how this is portrayed right at the beginning of the game. It feels like you're some big Hollywood actor, and it just kind of annoys me. Everyone on the face of the earth knows who you are, and I like to call this the Gordon Freeman effect. It's sort of the same issue. In Half-Life 1, you did this amazing, ridiculous thing, so by the time Half-Life 2 comes around, everyone knows who Gordon Freeman is. But in Half-Life 2, this never really bothered me. It did in The Darkness 2. Anyway, right at the beginning of The Darkness 2, you get attacked by someone, and you don't know who, but it was a very big, organized attack. You get a few hints, and after a few levels of you murdering people trying to figure out who put that original hit on you, you find that it was someone in a secret society called the Brotherhood, who was controlled by Victor. Victor is the main antagonist of the game, and he wants to control the darkness. In fact, that's the whole point of this secret society called the Brotherhood. They want to control the darkness, and they have an object called the Siphon that can do just that. You might think, okay, why wouldn't you give the darkness up? This is a way you can be free of your curse. Well, the darkness gives you a reason immediately. You get caught numerous times by the Brotherhood, and as they were trying to take the darkness from you, the darkness keeps confirming that he has Jenny's soul locked away. Jenny died in the previous game, so maybe the darkness is playing tricks on you, but no, it is confirmed Jenny's soul is with the darkness, and if you let the darkness go, you're letting Jenny go. This isn't confusing at first because the darkness always wants to have some sort of way to blackmail the host. He needs to have control, and Jenny's soul is a very good way to do that. But there's more reasons for it that I'll get into later. The format is actually somewhat similar to the first game plot-wise. You get caught by the secret society numerous times. In the first game, you got caught numerous times with the people trying to kill you, but those were a lot more memorable. I can tell you exactly what happened on each one of those, but in the second game I need a refresher even though I just played it. And just like in the first game, you do have near-death experiences, or literally die. But unlike the first game, you get transported into this sort of insane asylum. This is the one thing about The Darkness 2 that I remembered extremely well, and there's a reason for it. You're free to wander throughout this insane asylum with crazy people talking to you because, well, you're an insane asylum, so everyone else around you is equally insane. While you're rambling about being the Dawn and being possessed by the darkness, everyone's telling you that you're just not on your medication and we're trying to help you. It's left ambiguous as to whether this is really true or not, as you always come back to the quote-unquote real world, or what you think is the real world. What I will say is that these moments are a welcome change of pace. The game has a lot of combat in it, and these sections here are no combat. Instead, you're walking around finding some of the most genuinely funny parts in the entire franchise.
Hey, freak show. Either of your pals happen to have a knife on him?
Oh, Jenny. Where are you? Jackie, I'm right here, Jackie. I work down the hall. Oh, Jenny. I love you so much. I've been so mopey without you. You sure have. Kiss me.
Christ. This place better not be real.
Some of the dialogue in this area, honestly, is great.
But the humor doesn't take anything away from the severity of the moment you were in. And again, you will eventually come too. I should also probably note that the Darklings are very different in The Darkness 2 than The Darkness 1. See, in The Darkness 1, the Darklings were simply creatures you could control. You could spawn four at a time. They had personality, but they weren't a specific person. They were just creatures. In The Darkness 2, the Darkling is a singular Darkling that helps you. He has a specific voice actor, has a specific personality. He is the Darkling. He's not a creature or a species, he's just the Darkling. And he plays pivotal moments in the story. Well, the story continues as this crazy chase to find Victor and try to murder him so he won't take the darkness. And eventually you do just that with a boss that is not really that bad or great, but, you know, it exists. After you murder Victor, Jackie's true intent comes free. He's going to use the Siphon to kill himself. This is the only way he can die without the darkness repairing him. He just wants to meet up with Jenny. If the darkness truly has Jenny's soul, this is the only way he's going to get to it. Well, after Jackie murders himself with a Siphon, he's back in the insane asylum? Jackie understandably is upset, frustrated, and confused. You will recognize every single person in this insane asylum, and that's what makes it so good. And slowly, the truth about this place is peeled away, as the Darkling shows himself. See, the Darkling didn't show up sooner because it's a very big risk for him to do so. You are in the Darkness's mind. The Darkling may not be able to die in the real world, but in this world, the Darkling can. The Darkling eventually helps break you out of this insane asylum, and in the process kills himself. This always confused me, because why couldn't I just open that door? Why did he have to open the door with the light? There was no reason for him to do that. Perhaps it would have been locked to Jackie, but not the Darkling, but I don't know, that door just looks like one of those push bars that always open from one side. Anyway, I vaguely remembered this from the first time I played The Darkness 2, so the game has that going for it. This was memorable. The door he opens leads to a roof, you threaten to kill yourself, and then the game gives you an option. To stay with Nurse Jenny, or to reject the insane asylum. If you stay with Nurse Jenny, then this is just kind of how the game ends. You're with Jenny forever. It's underwhelming, and I wouldn't recommend this ending. If you reject Jenny, the truth about the insane asylum shows free. You are in the Darkness's mind. This gives you one last level where you're fighting weird creatures with weird guns, and this is pretty cool. Finally, you find the real Jenny, who the Darkness is withholding from you. You fight up numerous floors, releasing Jenny more and more at a time, until finally, Jenny breaks free. It's worth pointing out that throughout the entire game, you had been seeing visions of Jenny, and every time you did, the Darkness mentioned something about she's lying or they're lying. Well, the reason for that is that after you free Jenny, you have a brief moment of comfort, but quickly after that, it's revealed that Jenny is the host for the Angelus. The Angelus is the complete opposite of the Darkness, and they've been fighting since the beginning of time. Jenny's still in the Angelus, just like Jackie was still in the Darkness, but the Angelus leaves, leaving Jackie and the Darkness trapped in hell, and the game ends. It sounds like a shitty ending, but honestly, I don't mind it. The Darkness was never a happy-go-lucky type of story. There was always a bit of, well, darkness to it. What I'm more upset about is that The Darkness 2 tied up everything in the plot neatly at the end of the game, brought up a new conflict, and then ended the game, and we'll never have a sequel. At least, as far as I know, we'll never have a sequel, but it seems incredibly unlikely we'll get The Darkness 3. And that sucks, because this ending leads to a sequel that will never happen. Despite how disappointed I was with The Darkness 2, I would still like to have another game. Because the plot wasn't what was bad about The Darkness 2, it was written by the same person as the first game, it was just the execution, art direction, and voice acting. I mean seriously, the voice actor was the same for The Darkness in The Darkness 1 as it was in The Darkness 2, but listen to the difference between them.
The siphon! It will make us complete!
Shut up!
She cries, Jackie!
Same exact guy, just very different, and I like the one in the first game a lot better. But I've left one part of this out so far that I really need to talk about, and that's the gameplay. Now, people really like to exaggerate the gameplay in The Darkness 1. It was a slower paced game. Jackie walks slow, he doesn't have a sprint, the aiming is a little bit awkward. And in general, this is not a high-octane, fast combat game. That is fine. One of my biggest pet peeves is that people seem to think that a slow-paced game is a bad game, and I don't understand this. There is nothing wrong with a slow pacing if it's done correctly, and it's definitely done correctly in The Darkness 1. Especially since The Darkness 1 is more about this immersive experience rather than core combat. But I still found that everything that was supposed to be gory and disturbing was adequately gory and disturbing in the most satisfying of ways in The Darkness 1. It does have things I can complain about. People thought that shooting out lights got a little bit tedious, and they kind of did up until you got the demon arm, but once you get the demon arm, you can just casually press the right bumper as you're walking down hallways to break the lights. What I'm saying is that The Darkness 1 does have gameplay issues, but a few loud people seem to blow them out of proportion. Seriously, the fact that you have to shoot out a few lights or that the aiming is a little slow doesn't ruin the entire game. Those are minor hindrances that you'll put up with because the rest of the game is so damn good. And the combat itself really isn't awful. I still found it incredibly enjoyable every time I threw a black hole at enemies to watch them spin everywhere and then ragdoll in random directions. Same as that thing can be said every time I impaled someone with a demon dig and then watched their body ragdoll across the room when I let go. The combat may not be the best thing in the world, but it's unique, it's different, and it doesn't feel like other games. On top of that, the pacing perfectly complements the story happening around you. That's not to say you couldn't have improvements, but it definitely could have been much worse. The Darkness 2 actually did learn from this, and this is the one thing The Darkness 2 does better than The Darkness 1. The Darkness 2 has a lot more emphasis on combat, and I think this is partially because everyone has to have some sort of combat or explosion or something being shoved in your face in any given moment to keep people's attention now. This reminds me of an interview with Tripwire Entertainment, Tripwire being the developers behind Killing Floor and Rising Storm, where they said that Call of Duty has almost ruined a generation of shooter players. And I understand where they're coming from, because everyone expects this big, bombastic, Michael Bay type single player. And the same could be said about multiplayer. You see, they said this while they were working on Rising Storm, and Rising Storm was more of a slower paced, immersive multiplayer experience. They effectively blamed Call of Duty for the almost near complete lack of patience to get into new games these days. And it's a frustration that I actually kind of share. The Darkness One is a perfect experience to talk about when it comes to this. It's a slower paced game, and that's not inherently bad, but people won't even give it a chance or try to learn it because it's too slow, it's too boring, it's not good enough for me. The Darkness 2 takes it the complete opposite route, and the combat does feel good, but as a whole the experience feels a lot more shallow because of it. The guns are punchy, they have adequate recoil, you have skill trees, you get different abilities, enemies can be ripped apart, it all feels really good, but none of it is something that you're really going to remember years down the line. This isn't Doom 2016, it's The Darkness 2. And even though the combat is better in The Darkness 2, the general format of the combat is just less intriguing to me. The game is very much so a linear game. You have invisible hallway corridors to shoot enemies that non-stop pour out at you, and then you get some experience when you kill them that you can level up your different abilities. This isn't really deep stuff, and it's not stuff that's really going to be very memorable either. You might remember how satisfying or gory that kill was, but are you really going to feel the need to go back and play it again? Probably not. That's not to say I don't love the takedown animations, because I love over-the-top gore for the sake of having over-the-top gore. But when you're comparing that to the experience that The Darkness 1 gave you, it just feels so much more shallow than the gore we had in the first game. It doesn't feel like there's a real purpose for it to exist other than just, well, this is how we make the combat better and people will gawk at it, so why not? In The Darkness 1, it was because you are a hitman and also because the darkness is fucked. I don't know, you probably expected me to have more to say here when it comes to the combat in The Darkness 2, but I actually really don't. It just kind of plays like another shooter, just well polished. It doesn't have something different to talk about like the first game did. It does have some things I can complain about that kind of annoyed me. They do have different types of enemies, like ones that carry a bright light, and I'm not going to complain about that too much, that's your one weakness, so they're going to exploit it. But there was another enemy that had this weird energy type whip that would pull your weapon out of your hands, and I just found this really fucking irritating because it was really difficult to find your weapon again. I just got this 1887 shotgun. Where the hell did it go? I don't want to lose it. Everyone's dead. I just want to find my damn gun again. And then there were also the flashbangs enemies through, and at times it just felt like one of these would land at your feet and you couldn't do much about it and then you died. Anywho, if you can't tell, my opinion really hasn't changed. I'm still greatly disappointed with The Darkness 2 compared to the original Darkness. As one of my viewers best put it, The Darkness 1 is a better experience. The Darkness 2 is a better shooter. One of these is a lot more memorable than the other, and the other can be supplemented by playing any other shooter out there that does the same thing. What are you going to want to play? Doom 2016 or The Darkness 2? I'm gonna go play Doom. But what replaces The Darkness 1? It's a unique experience that doesn't feel like anything else out there. Its closest equivalent is the new Wolfenstein games, but that's still not The Darkness. I would absolutely love if Machine Games came back to make The Darkness 3. Because with the experience they have with the new Wolfenstein games, as the combat in the new Wolfenstein games feels much better than The Darkness 1, I feel like if they made The Darkness 3, it could be an amazing game. On top of all of that, I would just love to see them make something other than Wolfenstein. I feel like they're starting to get into a routine of just making a Wolfenstein game after another Wolfenstein game, and I want to see something new. But I'm dreaming, and this is very likely never going to happen. I forgot to mention that The Darkness 2 was made by a different developer, Digital Extremes, who is most well known for making Warframe. To me, it feels like Digital Extremes just wanted to make their own game, ignoring what the previous developer did. They wanted to say, we can do it our way, ignoring the franchise's history. Where have I heard this before? The end result is that The Darkness 2 doesn't feel like a sequel, it feels like a reboot. But if you look at the plot, it is a sequel, and this just makes me really disappointed. But that really does sum up how I feel about The Darkness 1 and 2. The Darkness 1 feels like a believable experience with a regular dude walking around in a fucked up situation in New York City. The Darkness 2 feels like a superhero movie to me. Quite literally, the only thing The Darkness 2 did better than the first game was the combat, and even that's not as memorable as combat in other shooters, so it doesn't do anything better in my mind. But at least it's on PC, even though I'm probably never gonna play it again, so that's a thing. I don't know, I'm sorry if you like The Darkness 2, but I really fucking hate how it turned out compared to the original game, and it's one of my greatest disappointments. I look at it in the same way that I look at Fear 2. Fear 2 on its own in a vacuum is not a bad game, but compared to the original Fear, it's a great disappointment. The Darkness 2 in a vacuum on its own is a good game, but as a sequel to a great game, it's disappointing. Thank all of you that watched me stream these two games over on Twitch. If you want to come follow me over on Twitch, my Twitch is twitch.tv/Jerick4GamingDragon. And if you want to further help me out, you can subscribe to me on Twitch or check out my Patreon, patreon.com/Jerick4. Thank all of you for watching. I will see you next video.